Gipalski about body composition of fecal deficient with a rheumatic inflammatory disorder. I also want to say to you that I have prepared some material of every presentation, just a summary of every speaker, not every presentation, but at least one of every speaker. Then you can collect when you leave now or tomorrow morning, okay? The second thing is, tomorrow, in the morning, we will have here the lecture, in this, but in the afternoon, we move to another one. Will be more convenient for streaming and also for the speaker, okay? Then, today, you can collect at the end a brief summary of every presentation, and tomorrow we will move in the afternoon to another lecture, okay? Thank you very much, and it's your time. Thank you.
Okay, so I promise also my last presentation of this course. I'm going to talk about something different this time. I'm going to talk a little bit more about disease. The common factor in my previous presentation and this one, it will be no surprise, will be energy metabolism, and more specifically body composition and also physical activity. And now I want to show a few results from one of the studies where you actually move from a healthy situation to a more disease situation. And the disease that I've chosen in my research, where I have a particular interest in, is rheumatic inflammatory disorders. And the reason I'm interested in it is because I've got rheumatoid arthritis myself. And so when I had to decide as a postdoc, like, which direction will I give my research, not being a doctor, it was difficult to find my way, like, where would I want to go? But then I found out that there's actually a lot of metabolic problems in inflammatory disorders as well. And so this area is relatively new to me, but it's one of my personal interests as well. So I will present something of my research in this. Now, in general, energy metabolism and disease, in this person, something has gone wrong. And this is an example of a patient with COPD, so chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And you can see immediately that he is very skinny, of course, and it's not just that he lost all his fat mass, but he also lost a huge amount of muscle mass. And that is a major metabolic problem later in life, and a very important comorbidity in these patients. And then you can ask yourself, what has happened to this patient? Is it just because he hasn't been eating? Or hasn't he been eating enough protein? Or just not enough energy in general? And that could have been, you know, maybe a historical perception that he's not eating anymore, so he's losing all his weight. But we now know there is a lot more going on, and that the inflammation itself in this patient, even though it's a lung disease, he has systemic inflammation, that inflammation is one of the important issues in why he's losing so much muscle mass and so much fat mass, and why he's getting metabolic complications. Now, if you allow me to use this slide once more, even though I've changed the background, it's the same slide as this morning, of course. In this patient, something has gone wrong, and it can be, as I said, it could be the nutrition. So maybe protein would be an obvious nutrient where you think about when somebody's losing muscle mass. But it also could be, of course, on the energy expenditure part. And most likely, it's a combination of both. And depending on the disease, one may be more important than the other. But again, I refer to this slide again, because I always see the human being as, you know, one big organism which has to take in energy, which is spending energy, and the body composition is the effect of both, and both will affect body composition as well. Now, if you look, and this is the last slide, which is the same as in the previous presentations, I promise. If you look at the energy expenditure again, you could think, what can go wrong in a patient with a certain disease or an inflammatory disorder. And one of the things that has been investigated quite a lot is the sleeping or the basal metabolic rate. And yes, if you have inflammation, the basal metabolic rate seems to go up. So your energy expenditure is increased as a consequence of the inflammation. And that is certainly true when you have an exaggeration of the inflammation. So if a COPD patient who have a bout of inflammation, an exaggeration, a peak, then his BMR would go up. So it would actually increase his energy expenditure and though his energy demands. On the other hand, you might think these patients are not moving a lot anymore. Perhaps rheumatoid arthritis, maybe their physical activity is affected and that might actually decrease their energy requirement because their total energy expenditure goes down as a consequence of this component decreasing. And you can question where is the balance? How much does BMR increase? How much does physical activity decrease? And where does it end up? Do they have higher energy requirements or lower ones? And what do you have to give them? Now, I still can't answer that question, of course, unfortunately. It may not be a surprise that I will focus on, again, the energy expenditure part and not so much the energy intake part. Let me start with one example. Again, a study in patients with COPD done at our university, but way before I was even a scientist. This is just when I went to university in 1995, so I was a student. And this is a study where they compared COPD patients with control patients. And the first thing you will notice is that the weight here of the COPD patients is a lot lower than that of the control subjects. So something has already gone wrong during the disease. Also very interesting, I think, is the fat-free mass index. So that indicates the amount of muscle corrected for height. So the fat-free mass has clearly decreased in this group, and that is a major problem, of course. And then if you look at energy expenditure, this one, resting energy expenditure, it is the same between both populations. So both are at 1600, so you would think that their energy expenditure hasn't changed a lot, but if you actually correct it for their body composition, the patients are a lot higher, so they are here. So you should always correct for body composition, of course, and then you see that clearly resting energy expenditure has gone up. Now, they took it a little bit further in this study. They asked the patients to do very simple exercise, which was just moving their arms forward and upward, just very low intensity exercise, only moving arms, and they looked at what is their energy expenditure by doing this very simple task that you do every day. Now, on the left side are the healthy subjects, on the right side are the COPD patients. Now, if they have to move your arms, if you have to move your arms, you can increase your VO2 here, so your energy expenditure basically, with 5 to 6%. It seemed to go up. The patients, on the other hand, needed twice as much energy to do the same very simple physical task. So an increase of even 14%. So this very simple thing, which you have to do every day, if you have to write now, you are doing the same thing. It's costing you twice as much energy as the healthy subjects. And it was also reflected in the heart rate. So the same exercise, here's the heart rate of the healthy subjects, and there on top is the heart rate of the patients with COPD. And that could have quite some implications on your energy requirements. If such a simple task has already such a profound effect on your metabolism, then you can imagine how much effect it could have on all the activities you have to do during all the day. Now, this is COPD, of course, and I told you I was going to talk a little bit more about rheumatic inflammatory disorders. And this is one study that I have found. I only found one, where they looked at the energy expenditure of patients with rheumatoid arthritis during exercise. And the exercise, this is rest. And these are the patients and there are the controls. So at rest, their energy expenditure was up by 12%. 12% higher than in the controls. And this is corrected for body composition. Then they started walking on a treadmill, speed goes up, and then at the end, not only the speed, but also the slope of the treadmill goes up. So the intensity of the exercise increases, and you can see that the energy requirements are up to 20% almost higher for the patients than for the control subjects. So also in this population, it seems that performing physical activity, even though you're doing exactly the same physical activity, the energy cost is a lot higher to do the same thing. And the number of subjects actually decreased as you go up, of course, because some couldn't make the high intensity exercise with the high slope and speed. Now the question is still how much, because this is running, how much would that affect your metabolism in daily life? And that brings me to general background of cachexia, or wasting disease, or muscle loss, or whatever you would like to call it. The cachexia basically, it literally means bad condition. And if you see this person, you can imagine that it is a bad condition. And you can define it as accelerated muscle loss. Pathologically, the accelerated muscle loss. And you can see it typically in cancer patients, COPD, but also in rheumatic inflammatory disorders. In the inflammatory, the rheumatic disorders, you don't always see this, you don't really see this type. But what you sometimes see is that the BMI has not changed, and the person looks perfectly healthy regarding body weight, but his body composition has shifted. So his muscle mass has decreased and fat mass has come in to replace the muscle mass, and there's the metabolic problem. Of course, if you have a low fat-free mass, you will be less able to do your normal physical activity during the day. You may lose your functional independence, your quality of life will go down, and for certain, at higher age, you will get metabolic complications. Such as, for example, insulin resistance or cardiovascular disease. Even though it has gone down, it is still a problem. So it has become an independent predictor of mortality. Independent of the disease, cachexia increases mortality. Now, about my own study then, rheumatic inflammatory disorder and cachexia, we have chosen for ankylosing spondylitis, and that I will explain now what exactly that means. So a little bit of background on that. Ankylosing spondylitis is a rheumatic inflammatory disease. You could say like rheumatoid arthritis, but different joints are being affected. So in this case, mainly the axial skeleton, so indicated here in blue, the axial skeleton is affected most. That means the spine and the hips, the sacroiliac joint in the hip here, is affected the most. It affects young adults, so it occurs at young age, whereas rheumatoid occurs mostly at older age. And it also has a male-female ratio of 5-1, so there's more males affected by the disease than females. And the common name is also Bechterew's disease, maybe that rings a bell. But the point is that it also leads to systemic inflammation. So a lot of pro-inflammatory cytokines circulating in the blood, which may affect your energy metabolism. The symptoms are, the main symptom is back pain and stiffness of the back also, which makes it a lot more difficult to move. And so their physical functioning and their functional independence goes down. As in many inflammatory disorders, they have a huge amount of fatigue during the day, so they find it difficult basically to stay awake or to be active. Reduced quality of life, of course, and increased mortality. And this is, you know, in the worst case scenario, or over the years, they will develop from this straight back to this posture where they are actually bend forward a little bit, making it a lot more difficult to move around. Not much research has been done about this in this population. In rheumatoid arthritis, a few studies have been done. One person found 14% reduction in body cell mass, so a decrease in the muscle mass. Another study found a 12% reduction in arms and legs lean mass, but they didn't use the perfect technique, I think, in my opinion, but it was at least an indication that also in this population it is not going well with the body composition. And of course they also had a lower functional strength, which is indicated here in this graph. Very simple test, sit-to-stand test or an arm curl test. You see that the patients perform less good than the controls. And then you can ask yourself, what is the link between rheumatoid cachexia or a rheumatoid disease and cachexia? And one of the main things that has been investigated is TNF-alpha. Tumor necrosis factor alpha is a pro-inflammatory cytokine, which many of you may know or may have heard of. Being secreted by macrophages, lymphocytes, but also by muscle cells, it has a very important role in many processes in the body, like immune function, inflammation, cell differentiation, and so on. Apoptosis, of course, also. And TNF-alpha actually has been called cachexin because of its central role in the cause or in the pathogenesis of cachexia. And of course, it's not the only pro-inflammatory cytokine, but it seems to play a central role in this whole process. Now, this same cytokine also has a central role in the pathogenesis of rheumatic inflammatory disease. So there's a good link between them. So there was one of the reasons why we chose this population also, because there's the TNF-alpha is a big problem in the inflammatory diseases, and it seems to be related strongly to the cachexia. In ankylosing spondylitis, they actually give anti-TNF therapy, and that improves this patient's function very rapidly. Within 1 or 2 weeks, the pain is reduced, the swelling is reduced, the inflammation is reduced, and they can function properly again. So it seems for some people, not every patient reacts to it, for some people it seems to be some kind of a miracle medicine, anti-TNF therapy. Now, if you allow me to go a little bit into which pathways could be involved, and these are not really molecular pathways, but just in general. So inflammation represented by TNF-alpha, but also other cytokines. On one hand, it will cause tissue damage, which will cause joint pain. So of course, joint pain will affect your physical activity. If you're in pain all the time, you won't move a lot. And then you come in this circle where the physical activity affects fitness and muscle mass and the other way around. And then on the other side, the TNF-alpha is also involved in decreasing protein anabolism. On the left side, it could also increase protein catabolism, which could increase energy expenditure, possibly. And both these pathways, of course, have a direct effect on your muscle mass, and then you get into the same circle again. And the end result over the years is here at the bottom, lower fat-free mass, increasing fat mass. Sometimes body weight is not affected, it's just the composition that has changed, and you see the increase in insulin resistance, cardiovascular disease, morbidity, and reduced quality of life on the other hand. Again, only one study I found on this relation between TNF-alpha and body cell mass. So these were patients with rheumatoid arthritis again. And you see there, although I think it's not a very convincing graph, but at least it's an indication that the higher the TNF on the x-axis, the lower your body cell mass will be. So there seems to be in this population a direct effect of TNF, or not necessarily direct, but at least a relation between TNF-alpha and body cell mass. So anti-TNF-alpha therapy, as I said, is being applied in rheumatic inflammatory diseases, in rheumatoid arthritis, but also in ankylosing spondylitis, and within a few weeks you see all this occurring. So decreased disease activity, pain goes down, functioning goes up, joints seem to be protected, and maybe if it's not too bad yet, you even get joint repair. The question is, what is the effect on body composition and what is the effect on physical activity? Well, that's a trial we are doing at the moment. So what is the effect of anti-TNF-alpha therapy? But that's a study that is still going on. The study I'll present today is a cross-sectional study where we haven't followed them over time yet. So basically, if I go back to this overview, what happens if you eliminate the TNF-alpha? Then you might affect the protein catabolism and you might affect the protein anabolism. And on the other hand, you could decrease the tissue damage and the joint pain, and then it's clear what the overall consequences would be. So that is the general idea, like block the TNF-alpha and see if you can affect this whole cascade from the two ways, and if you can affect physical activity, the body composition, and if you can prevent these metabolic complications later in life. As I said, a study going on at the moment. So the aim of the first study was, first of all, let's see how bad it is with these patients, and let's try to quantify the muscle loss that they have if you compare it to healthy controls, and then see which are the main determinants of that muscle loss. And of course, I can only measure a few determinants, but at least we want to identify a few relevant variables that may contribute to the muscle loss in these patients. And these were the subjects, and while you look at the subjects, I will have a drink. If I may. So now you all know, 25 patients, 25 controls, matched for age, and actually also matched them for BMI, because I wanted to know what is the body composition differences. So I matched for BMI, so that eliminates the research question, is there BMI affected? I know that, but I really wanted to look how, if you match for BMI, how is the muscle mass affected? They had to have the disease for at least 5 years, but on average, we had patients with a disease duration of, I think, 18 years, because, of course, muscle loss is a slow process and it doesn't occur from one day to the other. And for this cross-sectional study, of course, they were not on anti-TNF-alpha therapy, because I wanted to see what is, how bad is this population in body composition or in muscle loss. And I don't want to see what the effect is of a certain TNF therapy on their body composition. And these are the methods that I used this time. And I'm not going to explain the deuterium dilution again, because that's the same one as I used in the other study, of course. But I did use, in this case, a three-compartment model. So not four-compartment, but three-compartment model, where I used the BOD pot, which I will explain in the next slide, deuterium dilution, and from that you calculate fat mass and fat-free mass. For accuracy, you are almost as close as to the four-compartment model. So the three-compartment model is what we use in most of our studies to assess the fat percentage. Now this BOD pot, I'm not sure if you are familiar with it. Has anybody seen it or used it? Yeah? Do you know the principle as well? A little bit? You have seen it or you have done it?
I have done it.
You have done it yourself, okay. So basically if you can see the picture a little bit, it looks like a little cocoon, and most people find it quite fancy when they walk into the laboratory. I've been wanting to install some of these green lights behind it to make it a little bit more spacey. I will do that in the future. But it looks kind of cool, and it's an alternative for underwater weighing. So what it means is that I measured the exact same thing, body volume, as with underwater weighing. And with from body volume, I go to body density. And as you can see here, I have to make the same assumptions as I do with the underwater weighing. So this technique also has the same problems regarding assumptions as underwater weighing does. But the technique that is being used is quite different. And the major advantage, of course, is that you don't have to submerge somebody completely underwater. And the reason why I chose this one instead of the underwater weighing is because these patients have a lot of back problems, and they might find it difficult to be lying down on a stretcher for a few minutes, or yeah, maybe even 20 minutes in total, to be submerged underwater. So I chose for the BOD-POD, basically for convenience of the patients. And what it comes down to is that you measure the volume of the body in air instead of in water. And you have this inside the device, you have two chambers. This is the test chamber, so that's where the subject will be sitting. And this is the chamber in the back that you cannot see if you enter the BOD-POD. And in between is a little vibrating membrane. What will happen is that when you are inside the BOD-POD, the membrane will start vibrating. And as a consequence of that, if the membrane comes this way, the volume here decreases and the pressure increases. If it goes the other way, the pressure here increases and the volume decreases. Now there's a physical relationship between pressure and volume in one room to another room. So if you have a closed system, pressure times volume has to be the same in this room as in that room. As I perfectly know the volume of this room, and I perfectly know the volume of this room, I can measure the pressure changes and calculate the volume from that. So the volume of your subject is the volume with this of this chamber minus the volume of this chamber with the person inside. So it's based on the relation between volume and pressure, completely different from Archimedes' principle with underwater weighing. But the advantage is it only takes 50 seconds for one measurement. You still have to be in bathing clothes, as you indicated, so you still have to ask your subject to bring bathing clothes and to change, and you have to wear this nice swimming cap as well, because all the hair would influence your measurement. But again, it's very easy to use, and it's quite quick to use, and it's a little less burdensome for patients. Okay, then there's the same device again that you have seen before. So of course I have measured physical activity also in this patient population where they wore this accelerometer again for 7 days to measure the activities of daily life, total amount, but also the intensity, frequency, duration, and so on. We've tested them a little bit more. Of course, basal metabolic rate to look at energy expenditure. I've explained that this morning. And then we also did a VO2 max test, which I will explain just very briefly in the next slide, but I think most of you will be familiar with it. We took blood samples as markers of inflammation. One of the things that I measured was CRP, so C-reactive protein, which is a protein that increases very rapidly when inflammation is introduced. Could be any kind of inflammation. So it doesn't have to be a rheumatic cause, can be anything. CRP is one of these fast responding molecules to indicate that inflammation is going on. We've also measured the blood lipid profiles like LDL, HDL, triglycerides, and of course I've measured the TNF-alpha. And then on the other side you can see we have a lot of questionnaires that are basically being used in this patient population to assess their disease activity and how bad the disease is in this subject. So one questionnaire is disease activity. Second one is how good are they still functioning in daily life. There's one about fatigue, quality of life, and then there's a physical activity questionnaire which I introduced myself. And some of these questionnaires actually gave us some interesting results as well. Now the VO2 max test, perhaps most of you are familiar with it. You push your subject till the maximal performance. And you can do it on a treadmill or on a bike. I prefer to do it on a bike because it requires less coordination of your patients, and also patients with back pain. I don't want to put them on a treadmill because they might not want to collaborate. But the cycling went okay. So every single patient could perform the VO2 max protocol. So you put them on the bicycle, you increase the resistance every 2.5 minutes until exertion, until they cannot continue anymore. And at the same time, you continuously measure oxygen consumption to see how much oxygen the body can take up. So that's the VO2 max, and the VO2 max gives you cardiovascular fitness. Now, some of the results, and you may remember me as the guy who never finds any differences between these groups. The fat-free mass index, so I've corrected fat-free mass again for height, was perfectly the same between my both groups. And very funny, my fat mass index, or the fat mass index, was also exactly the same between both groups. So there hasn't been any change in the body composition. And then it's probably not a surprise that the BMR, whether I correct it for body composition or not, is also exactly the same between both groups. So there was no elevation in their energy requirements as a cause of this chronic inflammation. Now, to continue as the guy who never finds any differences, the physical activity even was exactly the same between the healthy and the arthritis patients. And so this is, let's see, control versus patient. Number one is the patients. The mean physical activity, and I've calculated from my accelerometer what the physical activity level is. And that is about 1.73, which is exactly a normal, healthy physical activity level of the normal population. So if you measure 1,000 people, healthy people, you would find a physical activity level of 1.7 on average. And that's exactly where my population is, both patients and both and the controls. The fitness, I've expressed it here as regression lines, but basically, on average, there was definitely no difference between the groups. So the VO2 max, they are equally fit. The patients are equally fit also as the control subjects. And that tended to be some different in the slope of the regression line. So this is fat-free mass versus VO2 max. So fat-free mass obviously is the most important determinant of VO2 max. If you are a very fit person, you would be over here. If you are a non-fit person, you would be over there. And I'm not sure whether there's really a difference in slope or whether it's a tendency or it's just coincidence. We'll see that in future studies. But anyway, on average, they seem to be equally fit, my population as well. But then we go to the plasma lipids. And surprise, surprise, everything is the same. So it looks like I'm looking at a very healthy population here, because the total cholesterol, not different, LDL cholesterol, not different, HDL, not different, and triglycerides, also not different. So also the lipid profile was exactly the same. Now then you can say, did you really measure patients? Because nothing seems to be wrong. So of course I have been looking at why I couldn't find any differences. And I'm one of those scientists who actually is interested when I not find any differences, because I think every result is an important one. To show you that I did definitely measure patients with inflammation, these are the CRP results. This is the control, this is the patient group. I've expressed it as a box plot because there was non-normal distribution, so then you don't look at the averages. And you see there's a huge variation, of course, where there's patients who have no active disease and patients with very high active disease. And on average, inflammation or CRP was about 3 times higher in my patients. So there's definitely indication of chronic inflammation there. The questionnaire on disease activity here was on average 4, and 4 means active disease. So on average, my population definitely had active rheumatic disease at the point that I measured them. And some will have high disease activity and some will have stable disease at that point. because rheumatic inflammatory diseases tend to go up and down over time. Now, what I did find interesting is this relation between physical activity and inflammation. So this is a graph of only the patients, but if you look at physical activity on the x-axis and on inflammation on the y-axis, you see this inverse relationship. So the lower the physical activity, the higher the inflammation, or the other way around. So you can say that those who have lower CRP values, lower inflammation, can be more physically active. Or the ones that are more physically active actually have lower inflammation. And I tend to go to the second hypothesis. Can't prove it yet, but I will, hopefully, sometime in the future. But there is, I can put also the controls in this graph, and you will see the same relationship. And there's been a few epidemiological studies in healthy persons as well, where you also see this inverse relationship. So being physically active might actually reduce inflammation. And how much of that is important in my rheumatic diseases, I don't know at the moment, but I think it may be quite an important factor. So I also did a little multiple regression analysis to see what actually determines their fat-free mass index. And then it's no surprise, of course, that gender is important, because men have a higher fat-free mass index. The fat mass index is important, because the more fat you have, the more fat-free mass you will have, because you have to carry around the extra fat mass. So you will increase, everybody who increases in fat mass will also increase in fat-free mass. And then the last important determinant was the physical activity. So the physical activity, and mind you, this is not exercise. This is just being physically active in daily life, everything they do in a week. That physical activity, normal daily activities, are positively related with your muscle mass, also in these patients with chronic inflammation. Now, some discussion then about this, that it was clear that they had chronic inflammation, they had a disease for over, on average, 18 years already. CRP was increased in a large amount of patients, but still they were equally active and equally physically fit as healthy controls. And I think that is the key issue to why I did not find any differences. This fact that they were quite active patients. And these patients are actually motivated by their doctors to move as much as possible. They get exercise therapy, and they actually know the less they move, the worse the symptoms get. As in functionality, which is mainly for functionality and keeping the muscles active, but now we also think that it may be protective for them not to develop cachexia, as long as they keep moving a lot, and perhaps it could even stabilize the disease a little bit, but that is hypothetical. And that is probably also the reason why we found no difference in the lipid profile, and I think this finding is still interesting, that the CRP is inversely related to physical activity. And I think it's time for lunch now, after I thank the research team that was involved in this study. So I would be happy to answer any questions about this, if there are any. No, we haven't done that. It's interesting, of course, provided that you can, you know, get the patients before they become a patient. And there's the difficulty, I think. We had a questionnaire about physical activity over, like the Bakke questionnaire, asked for physical activity over a period of about 6 months. There were also no differences. And what was interesting, because I forgot to mention that, if you ask all the questionnaires about physical functioning and quality of life, disease activity, all the patients score very badly. So they all feel that they cannot function properly. But if you measure it objectively, they do. And that was also something that we find interesting, that it feels to them that it's a big problem, and I can imagine why that is. And they feel as if they cannot function properly, but they do move equally as much as the healthy controls. But yeah, whether or not they changed it, that's difficult to say, because you would have to catch them before they get patient.
Do you think that by matching them for BMI, you've actually selected a subgroup of the patients who were actually healthier than the whole group as a whole?
That's a risk, absolutely. And even more importantly, by selecting those that don't get anti-TNF therapy, by definition, I select those that are not the worst case scenarios, because the worst cases get anti-TNF. And most likely, the more disease activity, that's where you will see problems occurring. And that's why in the next study we have because this was basically a pilot study, we've now used a lot larger group. So we're measuring 120 patients now. 80 patients of those, or 180, and 80 patients will get anti-TNF therapy, and we will follow them over time. So now I'm getting the whole range in disease activity from very low to very severe, and I will see what happens with the anti-TNF as well. But of course, you're absolutely right. Yeah.
Any more questions? Yeah. Okay, so thank you everybody. Thank you the speakers. So as you probably know better than I, afternoon is free, you can do whatever you want, and we expect to see you tomorrow at 9 in the same place, okay? Thank you.